vacation spots in Europe, Croatia. Wouldn't you like to get to know this wonderland nestled between the mountains and the sea? Come along with us as we explore Croatia's Adriatic coast. Our journey takes us from the island of Vis to the legendary city of Dubrovnik. Vis is located in the Adriatic Sea, a good 60 kilometers off the mainland. During the days of communist Yugoslavia, but also long before, Vis was a restricted area because of its excellent strategic location. Only at the end of the Croatian War in the 1990s was the island opened up for tourists. Vis is marked by the ruined buildings originating from the time of the early settlers. The ruins, declared to be World Heritage Sites, cover the landscape. Not much grows on the island's rocky soil, with the exception of vineyards, which produce the grapes for making wine. That is not the only source of income for the islanders besides tourism. There are only few places in the Adriatic that can boast of as many fish as are to be found in the waters around Vis. The daily catch of the fishermen of the town of Komica, for example, is sufficient to supply the needs of all the restaurants and pubs in the surrounding area, as well as on the mainland. And that, in spite of the fact that the fishermen's catch is limited by strict quotas. All efforts to raise the local wild tuna in fish farms have failed so far, and the quotas serve to maintain the populations of these endangered fish. But it is neither for its wine nor for its abundance of fish that the island of Vis is renowned far beyond its regional borders. The main reason for the day travelers from Split, or one of the many surrounding islands, is the Blue Grotto of Biševo. The small island has a landmass of only 6 square kilometers and can be reached from Vis in only a few minutes by boat. The island's limestone cliffs are pitted with several caves, and that's not only above the surface of the water. Local fishermen have known about the caves all along, but they were only officially discovered by Baron Eugene Rossonnet in 1884. When the sun shines and the waters are calm, light reflecting from the seabed bathes the inside of the cave in a fascinating blue light. This phenomenon of physics is particularly interesting at noon. Pure romance at temperatures that often exceed 28 degrees Celsius in the shade. From the Blue Grotto to the impressive cliffs on the mainland, we have arrived at Omish at the mouth of the Cetina River. Over the millennia, the river has carved a deep ravine in the Dinarian coastal mountain range. The town's location was settled very early on in recorded history. Omish became notorious in the 14th century after the retreat of the Romans. Under the sovereignty of the Slavic Narentians, the town became the center of piracy on the Adriatic Sea. Today, about 6,000 people live here and earn their livelihood honestly, mainly from tourism. In the backlands of the mountain ravine, the river has carved out a literal canyon with small lakes and waterfalls, some of them cascading as much as 40 meters down into the deep ravine. The 60-kilometer-long Makarska Riviera begins at the town of Omish. With its many small villages and romantic inlets, it is a popular destination for travelers looking for pristine, not yet overcrowded beaches, but also the renowned Mediterranean flair of the Adriatic coast. The water along this stretch of the Adriatic is considered by those in the know to be the most crystal clear. Karska is right about in the middle of the Riviera, right at the foot of the Biokovo Mountain. The city has a population of about 13,800 and is the most well-known tourist town on this part of the coastline. As with most cities in Croatia, this Mediterranean pearl also has a turbulent history. The nearly four-century-long Venetian occupation during the Middle Ages had the greatest impact on its architecture. Enormous effort went into modernizing the city after the Croatian War in the 1990s. New hotels, restaurants, and shops augmented the romance of the historical old city. That has made the city an attractive destination for many young vacationers as well, resulting in a lively community for all generations all along the Makarska Riviera. It is a good hour-long boat ride from the vacation town on the mainland to the island of Brats. With a landmass of 396 square kilometers, Brats is the third largest island in the Adriatic and the largest Croatian island. The Golden Horn, a 300-meter-long horn-shaped beach, is the island's tourist trademark. But Brač is about much more than a place for sun worshippers and the water rats that play in its crystal clear waters. The island is world renowned, and that because of its stone. The local museum in the historical village of Skrip is well worth a visit. Houses from ancient settlements are still standing today. The roof tiles were made from stone plates quarried and prepared by skilled stonecutters. Some are faced with the famous white Brač limestone. Many famous buildings around the world were constructed using this stone, including the White House in Washington, D.C. Besides a bas-relief of Hercules, a safe built during the Middle Ages is also displayed within the venerable walls of the museum. It is said to be the oldest of its kind. Just a short hop on the ferry boat takes us to the island of Hvar. Here as well, the culture lover is not disappointed. History as far as the eye can see. From the obligatory covered column arcades to, and this is different, probably the oldest folk theater in the Adriatic. Built in 1612, it was open to all classes of society. For Europe at that time, that was a real socio-political revolution. And there were good reasons for it. Many writers, actors, historians, and theologians lived on Hvar during its heyday from the 15th to the 17th century. These intellectuals started the process of equalizing the grievous social contrasts that existed between the nobility and the common people on the island. Even to this day, in the marketplaces and the alleyways of the city, the houses of the poor are right next to those of the more wealthy. That is still the case in many modern European cities today. But now most people can afford a little bit of luxury from time to time, and one appreciates the aesthetically pleasing habitat the historical buildings provide to all who live here. Coi pescatori che vanno per mare.
ampie tempeste poterà affondar, per questo caro bene io non ti posso amar. Tra le ampie tempeste potrebbero affondar, per questo caro bene io non ti posso amar.
The fragrances on Praj are also pleasing to the senses. Besides many other herbs and grapevines, lavender and sage grow wild among the ruins of former settlements on the Green Island's inland fields. Valuable healing and skincare oils are made from these aromatic plants. So Praj offers its visitors not only relaxation and an exciting history, but also enjoyment, healing, and wellness directly from nature's garden. The next Dalmatian island we visit is supposedly the birthplace of Marco Polo, one of European history's most famous seafaring explorers. Whether he was really born on Corcula or in Venice has never been scientifically established for certain. The moving history of the settlement of the island sounds just as exciting as that of most cities in the turbulent history of this country. And, as if every city followed the same construction pattern, it has its city wall with its fortresses and defensive towers, stairs leading up to the city gates, and any number of churches. It's a little bit like the modern metropolises of America. There comes a point where it just gets to be too much. The observer tends to lose respect for the imposing skyscrapers. In Croatia, that applies to the church towers and palaces. That is certainly a pity. It causes one to miss out on the incredible artistic detail of the architecture. The large altar in the apsis of the Cathedral of Corcula, for example, was built during the 15th century. The builder did the work for only 115 ducats, a 3.5 gram gold coin, and he didn't even get that in cash, but in the form of food and provisions. The main altar in the Church of All Saints is no less imposing. It was just built 100 years later. Sacred art everywhere you look. Optical overload is a term that doesn't only apply to our modern day. On Corcula, art appreciation means more than just standing, looking, and being amazed. Anyone wanting to get up to the Church of St. Antonius, for example, needs to be in pretty good physical condition. There are 102 steps leading up to the church that need to be overcome. In the beginning, monks lived up here as hermits. If the steps prove to be too much for anyone, they can take the ferry over to the small island of Badja and visit the Franciscan monastery, which has become pretty run down in the meantime. The building, built in the 14th century, has a colorful history. It was confiscated in 1950 by the communist regime of that time and used for military purposes. Later, it was turned into a sport and recreation center. In the new century, the Croatian government finally gave the monastery back to the Franciscans, and now they have to live with this run-down millstone around their necks. Maybe they will be able to raise the money needed to cover the enormous renovation costs by renting the monastery out for film production. After all, the House of God has already proven itself as a movie backdrop for the classic Black Pearls. their Croatians and their pleasures. People have lived simple lives from the beginning on Korčula as well, but that has never stopped them from making good wines and developing a diversified and hearty cuisine. Not much of anything grows in the bare rocky soil, but it is fertile enough for some types of fruits and vegetables, as well as olive groves. These conditions have given the inhabitants of Korčula no choice but to eat what today's nutritional experts recommend as a healthy and balanced diet. In times past, meat was only served on special occasions. Today, it is affordable more often, of course. Taken as a whole, island recipes are reminiscent of Italian cuisine. That can certainly be traced back to the time of the Venetians. Whale-cured, tender-smoked leg of lamb, goat cheese, and eggplant. Certainly a combination to make one's mouth water. It goes without saying, of course, that the delicacies are homemade. Enjoying these traditional culinary delights does not exhaust the cultural experiences Korčula has to offer, however. The islanders love to make music, and songs sung by men in multi-part harmony are very popular. In this case, the songs tell the story that goes to the famous sword dance drama, Moreška. The dance musical probably originated in the 17th or 18th century. It is not an authentic Croatian folk dance, but was probably taken over from the Venetian rulers. And this is the story. The kings of two conflicting parties are fighting over the girl Bula. The lovely young thing is already betrothed to one of the kings and doesn't want to marry the challenger, but he insists on taking her by force. That leads to war and besiegement. The girl falls into the hands of the aggressor at first, But the tide of the battle turns, and the soldiers of the fiancé gain the upper hand. The brave farmer's daughter returns to the arms of her beloved.
Utaži se, draga vila. Neće istina biti vi. Ne bi moga smrti u krilu tebe vidjeti. Moju dit.
Ti me dakle njemu vrati ako smrte trudi moja. Jer mi s tobom ni trati najgore moja nevoja i prim bi smrt odabrala nego tvoju ljubav koju neću.
Oružje! Družba stala, sprav Arapu njoj mrzeću. Da poštenje vidiš moje, ko veliko carstvo daje. Sad viteže skupi svoje, trpeć trudi, ratava je.
S dobre volje viteže, za steć vilu boj ću biti.
Vilu, koja mi srce steže, u oganj mili plemeniti. S dobre volje viteže, pripreman sam za dobiti. Hurra!
Nadar vire ove, primi nadar virnu mene.
A ovaj cijelo neka bude mila utjeha za moje trude.
The Marco Polo House in the city of Korčula also has a bit of a sing-song feel with only a casual relationship with the truth. Visitors should come with an expectation of entertainment rather than pure history and be prepared to take some things with a grain of salt. Even the museum curator doesn't seem to take his displays completely seriously. I am holding a small bag with 1 million grams of sea salt, he says. This play on the Italian word milione seems to refer to Marco Polo's alleged tendency to exaggerate the description of the riches he discovered in India and China in his famous travel journal. But Marco's complete last name was Polo Milione, so perhaps that is why we can have fun today with a 100 gram bag of salt being labeled as a million. The world has a sea battle to thank for Marco Polo's travel journal, which sparked the beginning of world trade. It occurred on September 7, 1298, off the coast of Korčula. 78 galleys from the Mediterranean Republic of Genoa faced off with 98 galleys from the Venetians, who ruled the Dalmatians at the time. Marco Polo commanded one of the ships.
Let's fight for our home, freedom, and honor. Let Korčula weave vain wreaths for our heads. Admiral Lavadoria from Genoa arrives in front of the...
The Armada from Genoa won the ferocious battle. 7,000 Venetians lost their lives, and Marco Polo was taken captive. One of his fellow prisoners urged him to tell about his travel experiences. He and Marco wrote the stories down, and the book entitled Il Milione, also known as The Division of the World, was the result. In spite of its serious consequences, the Sea Battle of Korčula is replayed every year as light entertainment in the form of an open-air play. Also located just a seaman's glance toward the horizon, the island of Mlet lies in close proximity to Korčula. its 37-kilometer length stands in stark contrast to its mere 3 kilometers in width. Trees cover most of the island. Mlet, with its idyllic bays and crystal clear waters, is one of the most beautiful vacation islands in the region surrounding Dubrovnik. A large part of its landmass has been made into a national park in order to retain the pristine condition of the island's jagged shoreline, the sandy beaches, and the rich flora, and to hinder the illegal construction of vacation houses. During the summer, the 1,000 inhabitants of the island nearly get lost among the flood of tourists from around the world. But their simple and down-to-earth lifestyle gives the island a special character which rubs off on the guests. A few fish for their own use and some for the vacationing guests are still caught in the classic fashion with fish traps. Hospitable people in the 13 small villages live as though time stood still 40 years ago. The journey into Mlet's inland is like traveling back through time. Guests are always welcome, and a camera team sparks the curiosity of not only the ladies. Typically Croatian, a hearty greeting isn't complete without a welcome shot of the local homemade brandy. The visitor isn't overwhelmed with artistic historical architecture here. It is the romance of the surroundings and the simple dignity of the people that leave the lasting impression. A world of yesterday, far removed from the hectic of typical tourism. And that does one good. Well-honed farming skills coax everything possible out of the rocky soil, from the fruit of the vine to other fruits and vegetables. Day trippers from the villages on the mainland are treated like family in the small village restaurant, as if they were just paying a visit from the big city. And the things that are displayed with pride are things of great personal value that stands in stark contrast to the invaluable artworks found in Croatia's churches and fortresses. The music is also much more casual. But that may be the very reason why the sincerity behind it gives the visitor more goosebumps than a large, elaborate cultural festival. We find it hard to leave this refreshingly peaceful patch of earth behind, but the Pearl of the Adriatic calls. The Peljesac Peninsula is joined to the mainland only by a narrow bridge close to the city of Ston. The peninsula is known for the longest city wall in Europe, The medieval city-state of Dubrovnik built the bulwark in the 14th century to protect its valuable salt fields. What made this wall unusual for its time was not only its length of over 5 kilometers, but also the fact that it was not built by slaves, but by paid laborers. -42°40' north latitude and 18°5' east longitude. These coordinates are well known to Mediterranean cruise ship captains. This is where Dubrovnik lies, the pearl of the Adriatic and the destination of thousands of tourists every year. Today, about 50,000 people live in this economic and cultural metropolis in the southern part of Dalmatia. They stand as a shining example of the determination of the Croatian people to fight for the preservation of their valuable cultural heritage. The robust fortified walls were not strong enough to withstand the attacks of the many conquerors over the centuries, and dramatic earthquakes have done great damage to the beautiful city. A major earthquake in 1667 left the entire city in dust and ashes, but the citizens rebuilt the city every time. The people of Dubrovnik even survived the ruthless Serbian campaign against the civilian population with its heavy artillery barrages during the Croatian War in the 1990s. In the meantime, at least the physical damage to the buildings has been repaired for the most part. The damage to the souls of the people is certainly another story. But as it has been since the 1950s, the steady stream of tourists from all over the world to this jewel on the Adriatic Sea quickly resumed. The surrounding mountains of the Dinarian Alps and some islands shelter Dubrovnik from the strong Mediterranean Bora winds that gives the city a mild, dry climate all year round. Even during the winter, temperatures rarely fall below 10 degrees Celsius. The Plaza forms the center of the old city and is one of the inhabitants' favorite places to hang out. It is something like a shopping mall in a romantic setting. As the only wide street in the historical city center, the plaza is also the site of festive events and parades. The city administrators are more than simply bureaucrats living in the fine feudal government buildings. They are also innovative thinkers. Already in the Middle Ages, they ran water pipes from freshwater springs to the fountains in the town, providing the residents with clean drinking water. The small and the large Onoforio fountains were built during that time. The Neapolitan Onoforio della Cava was the master builder behind the water system that carries the precious liquid to the city from its source in the Rijeka Dobrovatska Bay, 12 kilometers away. It is said that the naturally pure water still flows from the fountain to this day. As in all of the historical cities in Croatia, churches and monasteries dominate the historical center of Dubrovnik. They, as well as the city's several museums, are filled with sacred as well as secular art treasures of great value. Thank you. A special attraction is the pharmacy that was established in 1317 in the city's Franciscan monastery. It is still in operation to this day. And who knows, some of the natural medicinal preparations offered today may have had their origins in the Middle Ages. Rector's Palace is right next to Dubrovnik's historical city hall. The venerable masonry has survived quite a few exciting adventures, fires, the explosion of the gunpowder magazine in the basement, and severe earthquakes. Only a small portion of the original Gothic stonework the master builder Onoforio della Cava had adorned the building with remain. Over the centuries, various architects have left their own marks as they made the major and minor repairs needed. That is reflected both on the outside and the inside of the building. Art enthusiasts are transfixed by the paintings and handcrafted works of art. The layman can only stand amazed as the sense of the immense value of what is on display here dawns on him. This sense of amazement continues in the dome of the Ascension of Mary, with a bit of a time lapse. At first glance, the church gives a rather subdued impression. High vaulted ceilings and impressive sacred works of art, just like in all Catholic churches in Europe, but just not so overdone as in many others. But the dome's treasure chamber is among the richest along the eastern Adriatic coast, and probably far beyond. Dubrovnik's monopoly on the salt supply for a large portion of Dalmatia made it possible for the people of the city to gather such wealth. However, the dome was completely destroyed by the devastating earthquake of 1667. The hoard of gold and precious stones suffered great damage as well. But even that which could be salvaged as the restoration work progressed will take your breath away. Dubrovnik's church leaders must have amassed unbelievable riches. Priceless jewel-studded relics of the head and hand of Dubrovnik's patron saint, Holy Saint Blasius, have survived to this day. The abundance of splendor from bygone ages makes Croatia one of the most important locations for researchers of early European history. The many historical buildings and monuments that have been declared World Heritage Sites testify to the great cultures that have preceded our modern world, cultures without which we of the third millennium could not have developed as we have. Most of those traveling to Croatia in our day, however, are probably most impressed by more profane things. The breathtaking landscape of the sunny Croatian Adriatic coastland certainly taking first place. Right next in line is the amazing hospitality of the Croatian people, who were so recently traumatized by the horrifying events of war in the 1990s. Perhaps that experience has even helped make them a people who is able to appreciate more deeply and even find joy in the fact that visitors from all over the world find rest and relaxation and have a good time in their now peaceful country.